the one hand, look at our world. Our world, it seems, is full of evil. On the other hand, if God is good, all good, perfectly good, and God is running the world, how could there be evil? And wasn't there someone in the Talmud named Nochum who had terrible tragedies occur to him, and every time one of these terrible tragedies occurred, he used the expression, Gamzu Latova, this too is for good. We've learned that expression, that's become something that the Jewish people expresses. And his student, Rabbi Akiva, paraphrased the same idea, everything that God does is for good. So it sounds like, on the one hand, we're confronted by massive evil in the world, and on the other hand, from a religious point of view, we can't accept the idea of evil. And people then feel pressed to say that the evil must be an illusion. It must be an illusion. We're just not getting it. If we penetrate more deeply, see it more accurately, we would discover that there's really no evil. Now, what I want to show you is how you can live with the idea that evil is real. No sweeping gestures.
Amen.
Well, for the few who didn't see the trailer, let me introduce you to what the subject is for tonight. It's obvious to everyone that the world has in it a great deal of evil. I don't have to recite the list. You're all well informed. But there seems to be a problem. If there's a creator and he's running the world and he has unlimited power and he knows what's going on and he's morally perfect, then it seems he ought to be preventing evil, and then there can't be any evil. What is a religious person supposed to do facing our world realistically with its enormous surplus of evil and yet make sense out of this world given his religious perspective? How does one manage that? And on the surface, the Jewish tradition simply makes it harder to deal with because it has sources that seem to be on both sides of the question. There are sources that straightforwardly acknowledge, assert that there is evil in the world, and even, almost shockingly, that God himself does evil. There's a famous verse, which if you open a siddur, a prayer book, you'll see almost all of it with a little twist. God is Yotzer Ore Choshech, Ose Shalom Ore Esako. God forms light and creates darkness, makes peace and creates, now in the Siddur it says everything. But the verse in Isaiah says creates evil. It says God creates evil. And in Lamentations it says, from the mouth of the Most High come both good and evil. And there's a Mishnah which says, when a person operates in the world, makes his way through the world, things happen. Some are spectacularly good and some are spectacularly bad. A person should acknowledge God in whatever happens. If something good happens, there's a blessing to make, that God is good and does good. And if something bad happens, there's a different blessing to make, that God is a righteous judge or a true judge. And the Mishnah says, when a good thing happens, describe God as good. And when a bad thing happens, describe God as a righteous judge. This is practical law. This tells you what to do. This law presupposes that you know where you're swimming, that you can tell. Really, good things happen and bad things happen, and you can tell which is which. It doesn't allow a person to hide behind, how do I know what's going to happen? How do I know what God really means? It's a practical law. And you make the blessing that is determined by the event, including a blessing on bad things that happen. So those sources seem to agree with our natural intuition that there are bad things in the world. How that can be with an all-good God needs explanation. On the other hand, there was a man named Nochum who committed a crime, and he felt terribly guilty over the crime. It was a crime of inaction, but it cost someone's life, and he felt terribly guilty. And he brought down calamities upon himself. He cursed himself, so to speak, that he should suffer calamities. And he did. And to everyone, he said, Gamzu l'tova, this too is for good. This became an expression of the Jewish people for thousands of years. When something happens, you say, this too is for good. That sounds like he's not allowing it to be really bad. And his disciple, Rabbi Akiva, who also had some calamities, had a similar expression. Everything that God does is for good. So it sounds now like we have sources on both sides, which only deepens the mystery as to how we're supposed to deal with this question. In logic, there are two ways out. One is to say, when something seemingly bad happens, it's a false appearance. It's only an illusion. Penetrate more deeply, look at it more fundamentally, take it apart into its elements, and you'll see that it wasn't really bad, it really was good. The idea of evil in the world is just an illusion. God is good and everything in the world is good. We just don't see it correctly. That's one possibility. The other possibility is that there are really bad things that happen, and somehow that can be reconciled with God's goodness. And many Jewish sources take the latter position, that the evil is real, it's not an illusion, you can't penetrate more deeply into it. It is evil, and yet it can be reconciled with God's goodness. How could you do that? I'll give it to you programmatically. We'll talk about it in greater detail later, but I don't want to keep you in suspense, God forbid. I want you to imagine a pediatrician. Now, you're all young people, but I'm ancient. I remember when inoculation against disease was carried out by needle injection, and those were big, fat needles, not the paper-thin, you know, razor-thin needles that you have today. And a child did not want to get those injections, and it was multiple injections. And the poor child had to be held down by his parents, you know, screaming, the doctor. Okay, now, the doctor is causing pain to the child and immunizing him against disease. I think that means the doctor is doing something which is both good and bad. Immunization is good and pain is bad. I'll prove to you that the pain is bad because next year, when they invent immunization via a pill, you don't expect them to continue to use the needle, do you? If he continues to use the needle, he's going to be up for malpractice. So obviously using the needle is bad. So the prior year, when he injects the child, he's causing him pain, which is bad, and he's immunizing him, which is good. Okay, that's obvious. Now, shall I say, then let's analyze the doctor. The doctor's doing something which is both bad and good, then the doctor must also be both bad and good. There's got to be a little sadistic strain in him that explains why he caused the pain. But that's not right. That's not right. The doctor could be wholly good, wholly benevolent, wholly caring. He only causes the pain because it's a means by which the child can be inoculated against disease, and it's worth it. The fact that the action has in it some bad and some good doesn't mean that the agent also has some bad and some good. The agent can be wholly good, even though the action is partly good and partly bad. So that being the case, maybe there's a way to negotiate acknowledging the reality of evil and still saving God's goodness. If we think of God's goodness as the goodness of an agent, maybe we can do that. We'll talk about that more in a little while from now. Let's go back for a moment to the sources. What were the sources that said that everything is good? Twice. One was, this too is for good. Then there was Rabbi Akiva's, everything that God does is for good. Does a word in both of those formulations bother you a little bit, make you a little suspicious? What word seems to be extra, and the idea would be clear if you left it out? Let's take the first one. This too is for good. That's supposed to be the denial of evil. Evil's an illusion. It isn't really there. This too is for good. Five words. Which word should be cut out? four. This two is T-O-O, meaning this also. This also is, sorry, maybe I should have said it that way. In the Hebrew, it's not two. This also is for good. Why is it for good? Why is it for good? If I'm supposed to be told that evil is an illusion, it's a mistake, it's a false picture, I should have been told this too is good. This too is for good? That sounds like defeat. I ask you, why is there X? See, you know why there's X? Because eventually X is going to lead to Z, and Z is good. Doesn't that mean you've given up on X? You've given up on X. No, you're right. X is a problem. Boy, do I wish we could do without it. But we can't do without it because we got to get to Z. Z is terrific. I'm going to use X to get to Z. Then I've given up on X. If X were good in itself, then I should leave Z alone. Forget about Z. I should just teach you how to look more deeply into X and see that X itself is good. And we don't do that. We say this too is for good. That sounds like X is a means to get to some other good. But not that X itself is good. That's surely the case with the doctor. The pain of the child is only a necessary means to get to the immunization, which is the good. He can't get there without it. So it comes out that even the sources that seem to deny the existence of evil aren't so clear. And therefore, there's a tremendous balance of Jewish opinion that the evil we see in the world is really evil. We don't have to struggle with this conflict. It's even an emotional conflict. How can I relate to the world with its evil, having to think that because God's running it, it isn't really evil? No, you can relate to it as evil, because it is evil. Now, there's another application of this idea, which one hears from time to time, even by people who I would say perhaps could know better. When a humanly caused tragedy takes place, keep up with what's going on in the land of Israel over the last few weeks. You've heard of a bunch of them. When one person victimizes another, injures another person, causes them a loss, or in the extreme case, murder, you sometimes hear people say, well, let's see, if A killed B, who's running the world? God's running the world. If A killed B, if A succeeded in killing B, then B's time was up. B had to die. Otherwise, if God's running the world, he wouldn't have let A succeed. You know, A pulls the trigger, a breeze can push the bullet aside, or B can faint and the bullet can go over his head. God has many means by which to foul the results of a person's planned evil. If A succeeds in victimizing B, B must have had it coming. God had decreed it for him. A is just a means. And if A in the last moment had said, no, I can't do that, then B would have been struck by lightning. Because B had to go. That's an idea that you hear expressed sometimes, but many Jewish sources disagree with that. Many Jewish sources admit that people can actually harm one another. They can actually injure one another. Some of you know the story of the brothers ganging up on Joseph and selling him into slavery. Now, they're out with the sheep, and Joseph is coming to meet them. They see him coming, and they say, he's had these dreams, he's trying to take over, and we're going to get him. We're going to get him. Reuven, the oldest brother, says to his brothers, let's not kill him. Let's not shed his blood. Let's throw him into a pit here in the wilderness. The Torah testifies Reuven's purpose was, after we throw him to the pit and we whip him elsewhere, I'm going to circle back and take him out to return him to his father. I don't want him to die. The Talmud says, we know the flora and fauna of that area at that time, particularly the fauna. The pits were inhabited by snakes and scorpions, poisonous reptiles. What did Reuven think he was going to accomplish? By convincing the brothers to throw Joseph into the pit so they won't kill him, so the snakes and scorpions will kill him. Don't tell me he wanted to keep their hands clean of the blood. The Torah testifies that he wants to save his life. He's planning to save his life and bring it back to his father. What was Reuven's thought? Explained by the Zohar and the Orachaim, this is for the tape, and for the various authorities, his thought was this. What are the options here? Either the brothers will catch him and kill him, or they'll throw him in the pit with the snakes and scorpions. Maybe Joseph has enough merit. he's beloved enough by God that if they throw him in the pit, God will do a miracle to save him from the snakes and scorpions. But that amount of merit, that amount of love that God has for him, won't save him from the hands of the brothers. It won't be sufficient. In other words, there's a certain level of merit for which God will do a miracle to restrain nature, that Joseph won't be hurt by nature. But when it comes to the free will of the brothers, God says free will is very important to me, and to overrule free will requires a much bigger cause than the amount of merit that Joseph has. There's at least a possibility. And therefore, if the brothers strike him, they'll succeed in killing him. But if they throw him in the pit, he's gonna live, because God will do a miracle for him. So under those conditions, if he ends up in the hands of the brothers will really succeed in killing someone who, under other terms, God would prefer to live. Just that God doesn't want to compromise people's free will. That means that people can really injure one another. That means if A injures B, one has the right to look at A as fully responsible for the outcome. Sometimes people soften it in their minds and say, well, if he hadn't done it, somebody else would have done it because he deserved it, so it isn't really that bad. No, it really is that bad. It really is that bad. When a person uses his free will to injure another person, then he bears the full weight of the responsibility for what he did. Okay, the bottom line is that we're looking at evil as real. We're not blinking. We're not turning our faces away from it. And we have to understand how that can be in God's world. The first step was to compare with the doctor. The doctor causes pain to immunize because the package deal of pain plus being immunized is better than the alternative, which is to be without immunization. Now the critic here is going to say, but Rabbi, that's not a good analogy. That's not a good analogy at all. Listen, Rabbi, why do we excuse the doctor? We excuse the doctor because he can't do it any other way. He can't immunize the child without the needle at that stage in medical practice. So he's stuck because he has only a limited amount of power, a limited amount of understanding. So he's stuck. He's got to use the evil means in order to get to the good end. But God isn't stuck. God isn't limited. God has unlimited power, unlimited understanding. Why can't God get to the end without using the evil means? You haven't yet succeeded in explaining why God needs evil in his world to get to the ends that he wants. Now, there are two stages to answer this question. First of all, I want to think for a little while about the idea that God can do anything. This seems to be obvious. It's something that we associate that idea with God. If anybody told me that X had limitations, I'd say, well, then X isn't God. God doesn't have limitations. But it isn't that simple. It isn't that simple. Can God really do anything? Let me try some examples on you. Could God learn something new? Learn something new. That's a genuine ability. Everyone in this room has it. Does God have that ability? Could God improve? Become better? That's a genuine ability. Everyone in this room has that ability. Could God improve? I hope those questions make you feel a little uncomfortable. God learned something new? If he could learn something new, that would mean that he didn't already know everything, right? As someone said over here. Right, and that would mean that God is imperfect. If he could improve, that means he isn't perfect, which means he's imperfect, which also doesn't sound right. The truth is, we don't want to say that God can do anything and everything. We don't want to say that. What we want to say is that God is perfect, and he can do everything that a perfect being should be able to do. Some abilities are built on imperfection. Some abilities are only for imperfect beings. Those abilities, we don't want to say that God has. That's one observation. A little more subtle observation is this. Here's another set of questions, which I'd like you to think about before I analyze them. What do you think about the following possibility? God has challenged me to a game of chess, but because he's a much better player than I am, he's giving me an advantage. He's playing with only his king. I have all my pieces, and he only has his king. query, can God checkmate me with only his king? Now, I know that would be hard for you and me, but this is God. Still, can God checkmate me using only his king? Can God divide 2 into 5 evenly with no remainder? Can God correctly spell the English word table with exactly 4 letters? Doesn't it sound like something's going a little off the rails here? What kind of questions are these? Jewish philosophers ask, will we say that God can make square circles? And they answer, no, we will not say that. Any description that contains a contradiction in it, we don't say that God can do that. Square circles are a contradiction. Checkmate with just the king is a contradiction. Dividing 2 into 5 evenly is a contradiction of the laws of mathematics. Spelling the word table with 4 letters? Even after some samples of bourbon, we know that you have to have 5 letters. Can't do it with 4 letters. So, when what you describe isn't consistent, we don't want to say that God can do that. Not because, this is the first slightly subtle remark, not because it's too hard for God, but because nothing's been described to do. Let me make this vivid for you. Let's take square circle. Someone calls you up and says, I hear you're going to the mall. Yes. Do me a favor. You have $25 extra that you could spend for me? Yes. Buy me a square circle, okay? So where would you look? In the supermarket? In the clothes store? In the candy store? In the game store? Where would you look for a square circle? What would you say? I think you'd say, what? Square circle? I'm sorry, I don't get you. Tell me something else. I don't understand you. I don't know where to begin. I know what square means. I know what circle means. When you put them together, nothing lights up in here. It just doesn't resonate. There's nothing going on. Square circle means nothing to me. It's an open contradiction. It means nothing to me. To ask whether God can make a square circle is like asking, can God blah? And when someone says, blah? What's that? I don't know what blah means. Don't ask that question. Can God do it? God can do anything, right? God has no limitations, right? Then he can blah also. No. Blah doesn't mean anything. It doesn't say anything. It's just nonsense. In that respect, square circle is also nonsense. Checkmating with just the king is also nonsense. Dividing 2 into 5 evenly is also nonsense. And square circle is certainly nonsense. They're all nonsense. We're not going to say that God can Q, where Q is just nonsense. And by the way, I wonder how many of you have heard that old chestnut, can God make a stone too heavy for him to lift? Now watch. If you say he can make it, then he can't lift it. And if you say he can't make it, that's what he can't do. He can't make it. So either way, he can't make something. Order the cheeseburgers. God's down. God's down. We refuted God. Very simple, right? Try this on your rabbi friends and see what they say.
That's a good one.
But you see, the answer here is going to be the same. Can God make a stone too heavy for him to lift? The right response is, what? Stone too heavy for God to lift? Stone too heavy for God, who's omnipotent, all-powerful, to lift? Stone so heavy that God can lift it and can't lift it? That's just a contradiction. And if it's a contradiction, you haven't asked a question. You haven't even asked a question. So when someone says God can do anything, there are two withdrawals we have to have from that idea. Some things he can't do because they're associated with imperfection, like learning something new or improving. And sometimes when you say, can God do X, and you put in the X certain words, you end up with nonsense. I don't want to say that God could do those things either. By the way, I don't want to say he can't do them either. There's no them to do or to not do. I want to reject the whole form of words. Excuse me, you're not talking sense. I don't want to say yes, and I don't want to say no, because you're not making sense. Okay, now, for the payoff. Why doesn't God make the good end without the evil means? Maybe, if you look carefully at what the end is, and you look carefully at the evil and the means, you'll see that getting to the good end is impossible. It's a contradiction if you try to get there without the evil means. The evil means and the good end form a unit. You try to break it up, you end up contradicting yourself, you end up with a square circle. Let me briefly describe that, and I'll be finished. What is the good end? What is the goal of the whole production, the goal of the whole creation? The goal of the whole creation is that human beings should have the greatest good that a human being can have. The purpose of the creation is wholly benevolent. God wants to give good. Okay. But God isn't going to be satisfied with a partway good. He's going to want the greatest possible good that human beings can have. Now, God himself is the greatest good. So what he wants to give to man is as much godliness as a creature can have. If I am as godly as a creature can be, I have the greatest good that I can have, seeing that God is the greatest good that there is, because he's perfection. So God says, by the way, that's why it says in Genesis that God made us in his form. That's a verse. This is Luzzatto's philosophy that I'm giving you. Luzzatto's philosophy is deep enough to go behind the verse and explain where the verse is coming from. Why wasn't God satisfied with horses? Because he could do better. Because he could give more good to a creature than a horse can support. He can create a creature that shares something in common with God, shares a certain form or essence in common with God, and that creature has more good than a horse does, which doesn't share that feature, doesn't share that essence. Now, one essential feature that God has is that he's independent. He's independent. He is what he is because of himself. Nothing makes him, nothing causes him, nothing creates him, nothing changes him. He's totally self-defined, self-contained, self-determined. He wants to give something like that to a creature. Let's talk about limitations. Could God make a creature that's totally self-determined, self-contained, and self-defined? Surely not, because it's a creature. If God's creating it, it can't be totally self-defined, self-contained, self-determined. God's creating it. Okay, can't be 100%. But could he give that creature some element which makes him independent? Sure, he could give him what?
Free will.
He could give him free will. That's why free will is so important. Only with free will can we resemble God at all. Otherwise, we are slightly smarter squirrels, as a certain train of thought would imply, which I'm sure you're familiar with. Or we have the same inferiority that angels have, because they also don't have free will at all, or certainly not significant free will. Free will enables us to be godlike. So God creates us with free will. Well, free will has a cost. Number one, free will requires us to be detached from God. If God were manifest in front of us, if we experienced his presence directly all the time, there would be no free will at all. When I talk to parents about how to raise their children, and this is just a snippet, but it applies here. You tell your seven-year-old, don't take cookies from the cookie jar. You put the cookie jar on the table, you draw your chair up to the table, and you sit and watch the cookie jar. What is the seven-year-old going to do? Of course, if he's Israeli, he'll just take it in front of you. But okay, we're talking about more reasonable American kids. American kid's not going to take it, and he's not going to learn anything. He's not going to grow. He's not going to become more mature. No. You have to tell him, don't take cookies from the cookie jar, and then leave the house. Leave him alone with the cookies and let him struggle. That's how he builds his character. That's how he builds self-control. That's how he builds relative values. It's only because God withdraws his presence from us or hides his presence from us, those are two different formulations, that we have free will at all. But God's withdrawing, God separating himself from us for the soul is painful. It's painful. Like the injection to the child who gets immunized with a needle. This is also painful. Also, as I was discussing with one of the company here before we started, if the world's events too clearly mirror what I do, I won't have significant free will. If every time I do the right thing, my stocks go up, and every time I do the wrong thing, my stocks go down, I'm not going to have significant free will. I'll just be investing in my stocks. To have free will, I've got to be able to do the right thing because it's right, and resist the wrong thing because it's wrong, not because I make a profit out of it. I have to be able to make moral decisions on moral principles. So then the world has to appear to be more or less accidental, where I don't get a payoff when I do the right thing, and I don't get hurt when I do the wrong thing. But then that's painful. That's painful for a person to live in a world where he doesn't see God's presence, he doesn't feel God's hand, he feels sometimes abandoned. King David expressed that in the Psalms. My God, why have you abandoned me, King David writes. Because it feels that way. His theology isn't mixed up, but it feels that way. And his exalted poetry expresses those feelings. So God creates a world in which there is evil. I mean, this is just the tip of a gigantic iceberg, but here you can begin to see how it works. You can't get to the end of being godlike and having the supreme good unless you're self-determined, to the extent that a creature can be self-determined. You're self-determined with only with free will. That's what free will means. Free from God's causation. Free from his manipulation. You did it on your own. You can only do that if God hides his presence and if he creates a world that seems to be indifferent to your efforts in moral terms. Only in that way can you have real freedom. That's a world that has pain in it. That's a world that has doubt and worry in it. Those things aren't good. They're necessary evils. You can't get to the end without it. Because being self-determined requires that free will, and you can't have free will without those things. So here's a case where you can't ask, why doesn't God get to the end without the means? Because when you try to describe the end without the means, you end up with a contradiction. Time for a summary, and then questions. We started with the observation, the obvious observation, the world is full of evil. How are we going to deal with that from a religious point of view? The answer that I'm describing to you tonight is this. The evil is evil. Those horrific pictures of Daesh, the Islamic State, and their horrific barbarism in the way in which they deal with people. And frankly, as some commentators pointed out, what happened in the Midwest, where someone lost his job and went to the place of work and decapitated one of the female workers, and then was on his way to another one when someone who happened to have a private gun shot him. And he was inspired by the videos that Daesh put up on YouTube. The world has brutal, vicious evil in it. We don't blink. We do accept that. We do accept that and realize that. If we ask how that can be reconciled with God's goodness, the answer is it's a necessary means to a greater good. And if you ask why must it be necessary for God to go through the means to get to the good, the answer is describing the good without this means is a contradiction. You can't ask why he doesn't skip the means any more than you can ask why God doesn't make square circles. This is a way of looking at the problem of evil, which a tremendous number of Jewish sources espouse. And I don't know about you, but for me, when I learned these sources, it gave me a sense of relief. I find it very difficult to have to turn my face away and not face something. I want to be able to face the world. I don't want to have to lie about the world. I don't want to have to make a pretense about the world. I want to be able to face it realistically and deal with it the way it is. To be told that it's all an illusion and I can't really deal with it because I'm not understanding it correctly was something that was very distasteful for me. And these sources enable us to accomplish that.